look at things the way they used to be, the more I'm convinced that in some areas they're still the same. Many years ago, long before the university opened up its arms completely to what we call equal educational opportunity, the city of Ames opened up its heart through its citizens by establishing for African-American students a home away from home and a house of hospitality for everyone. So today we gather to pay special recognition to that family, Nancy and Archie Martin, and to bring you special welcome from the city of Ames. Who opened up his heart is the mayor, and where's the mayor? I just saw him. And here's Ted to bring you special welcome. Ted.
Thank you, George. Welcome for all of the Martin and Ship family who were returning to Ames, kind of their roots area. You know, Ames has, in the past few years, kind of revitalized the downtown, and one of the themes has been the history of the community. Main Street has been related more to the railroad since that was kind of the founding basis for this community. But here on Fifth Street, there are a number of piers that depict the pioneer spirit of the community. But I don't believe that there is any pier that depicts it any more than the Archie and Nancy Martin Pier. You know, as George alluded to, Iowa State University had the foresight to open its doors to all students, no matter what their color, what their race, what their ethnic background. But the policy didn't go far enough because it didn't provide if people partook of that educational opportunity where they were going to live and be in the community. And as I looked at this picture, I have to tell you, the grandmother on my mother's side was a little lady, and when I look at Nancy's picture here, I can just imagine, I probably did not know her, but I can just imagine her saying, "Archie, that's not right. We need to do something about it." And they did. Am I close?
Yeah.
She probably took care of all the problems. And Archie said, "Oh, yes." And so they were the first that opened their homes and their hearts to give an opportunity to students of color. And we couldn't be more proud as a community to have the Martins be a part of this community and its history. And again, I welcome all of you. I would like to take the opportunity to invite or introduce a couple of council members that are here. Russ Cross from the City Council. Over here, Council from the 4th Ward, Herman Kornbach. So again, I'd like to welcome all of you. Any of you I know have some relationship to Ames High, and if you would like, after this dedication, I'd be happy to take you over. City Hall is now the old Ames High School. I'd be happy to take you over and take you through a little bit. Okay? Thank you.
You know, in any organization or in any crowd of people or in any type of event, there's always one person who's always making work for someone else. They're always pushing something, and then they come give it to you and say, "Well, you get this done." Well, the next person I'm about to introduce has many of those characteristics. Joanna Kazoo, will you come forward?
I was going to say Joanna.
I'm going to pass the buck on that one. But first of all, I wanted to thank the mayor and the city council and city manager's office for helping us with this project. And not only that, for having the pier rebuilt, because the first time it was built, it wasn't perfect enough. So this is the second version of the pier. So this is not the one that was here in February. This is a brand new dedication of the pier. Secondly, I wanted to recognize all the members of the Martin family, because without the original Ames Martins, Archie and Nancy, and all of their descendants, this would not be possible. So first of all, I'll just introduce Mildred Crouch, who is possibly one of the member. Should I say that? I mean,
yes,
women, do you? And then your brother is where somewhere?
Lamar.
And Lamar is over there, Mildred.
He is the oldest. I'm the
second
oldest.
All right, Mildred made sure I know she's not the oldest. He is the oldest. Okay. And then could I get all of the Martins and their descendants, cousins, or whatever, to raise their hands so all the rest of us can applaud, okay? And you'll see I'll pass the buck. And actually, today was a difficult day because there's graduation. So Terry Adams was not able to be here, who is the secretary. And Doris Ricks, who is the treasurer, has health problems, so wasn't able to be here. So, and Joyce Samuels, are you here somewhere? Where are you? Okay, good. So Joyce Samuels, and she will talk a little bit later also. And any other members of the Martin Foundation here besides Ellen?
Pauline.
Oh, okay. Pauline is coming next. Okay, but Pauline Martin and Ellen Hedwiger, these are the members of the foundation, okay? And Ellen, I'm passing on the buck, notice. Ellen is the person who got it all started and who got me working, you know, so we've got to talk to her. So here's Ellen.
About 2 years ago, my son David was visiting from New Mexico, and I wanted to see how the downtown had changed. So we walked 8th Street, and then we walked 5th Street, and we looked at every single pier, and when we were finished, I said, on one of these piers. So I called Pauline, I think, and we formed our community. Joanna just arrived. And we wrote a letter to Nancy Polster of the Arts Commission, telling her about Archie and Nancy Martin that we'd like to have them on a pier. And anyway, the pier project isn't finished until Archie and Nancy Martin are on the bed. So I walked 5th Street again and found this corner with no pier. So I called Bob Kindred, the assistant city manager, and he said he'd have to come and look at the corner. And he called me a few days later and said, well, I guess you can put your pier there. And Joanna Porteau, with the help of Don Newgrove, an attorney, established the Martin Foundation at First National Bank, and Signer Printing provided all the stationery and the letters we sent out and the cards we returned. And we met at the Calvary Methodist Church and sent letters to all of you who are here, who have contributed, as well as our family and friends. And we were able to raise $9,500. And the City Council gave us an additional $2,500. And so we're able to be here today to honor this remarkable couple, Archie and Nancy Martin.
So you really have to admire Ellen Hedwiger for having, you know, for harnessing all of this energy and for getting me to work for her, too. That's hard to do. But the cause is wonderful in this particular case. It really is great, and it is long overdue that the Martin family be honored. And so, but locally, you know, not everyone who is a descendant of the Martins lives in Ames. And so, of course, we try to get that person who would be willing to do all of the footwork And that was Pauline Martin. And it's incredible what she's done. Look, she brought you all here today. She organized everything. And she wanted to make that forward. So Pauline, you gotta come here. You gotta be in the front.
It's been a real pleasure for me to be on this foundation because, you know, we really appreciate what our grandparents were to us growing up. And it's been fun talking to family and gathering pictures and just enjoying the history. And I'm not a spokesperson, so I'm going to pass this on to Mary and then Karen. Because Mary has some things to share with you.
Hey, beautiful family, and it's an extended family. I'm Mary Martin Carr, Archie and Nancy Martin's granddaughter, and daughter of Paul and Esther Martin. And you'll get to meet many family members. We were talking about many things, and I've gotten to talk to some people that knew our grandparents also. Somebody whose parents built a house next door to the home where our grandmother, or the Delta Phi Phi house where our grandmother worked, said in 1914, said that he would go over there and grandma would give him cookies or carrots. And his mother didn't have much money, so when she needed to do something, he would go over there. I guess my grandmother babysat. And he remembers them and thought that was special. Speaking with one of the other students who live in their house, the remarkable thing is that nobody realized their age. And when I said their ages at the time that they were doing these things, they couldn't remember. I mean, they couldn't believe it. And we age well. our grandparents are their children, and I'm going to take a minute to mention their children that lived in Ames that many of you knew, and I, Aunt Nell, Mrs. John Shipp, was their daughter, and John Shipp was her husband. My parents, Paul and Esther Martin, my aunt and uncle, Robert Martin and Ethel Martin, and by the way, Bob and Paul married twins, and then Uncle Al, who was the first Martin to graduate from Ames High and started his family here, and some of his children were born here, and he died in Ames, and I hadn't known that either. We're learning new things. But those families are all represented. Their descendants, plus Richard Simmons, some of his family are here. That's one of their children. And I'm going to be brief because you'll have a chance to visit with more people and hear from more people. But I think the remarkable thing is that they were very caring, family-oriented people. And they taught us to be. And when our grandparents, as they aged, as they were ill, and they died in their own homes, and their children, their daughter Nell, their sons Paul and Bob, their son Archie from Des Moines, took care of them in their homes so they could remain in their home. And that tradition continues in our family today. Grant took care of, and Ann took care of their mother and the other daughters also, and sons. We've been taught to be very caring. We're always there for each other. We value what we got from Ames. I think that's part of the privilege of having grown up in this community. We've always maintained touch. But I think the remarkable thing is when our father built his house, he said to his father, "Dad, who'd have thought it?" Well, I'm sure our grandparents are looking down today saying, "Who'd have thought it?" So this is an honor that we would never have dreamed would have been bestowed on them, but they deserved it. And we thank you for thinking of them in such a magnificent way.
Is Karen here?
No. I thought, rather than repeat some of those comments in a different way, I thought it might be nice to have Fred come up because he not only was one of the older ones, but he lived at the house with the other students, so I thought maybe you might like a little bit of a different viewpoint from him.
Wondered why this house stood out so much when everything else was
other members who would like to express words of appreciation? I'm gonna get the doctor. Now, as we go over the program, I know it says appreciation from the African American community by George Jackson. I think if I did that, that would be like secondary. So I'm gonna give you an opportunity to hear from somebody who actually lived in the house and who has demonstrated to me throughout his life just what I think the Martins demonstrated. It's creating opportunity for young people. But this time we'll hear from Dr. James Bowman, who actually lived in the house. Dr. Bowman.
I'll try to speak up so everybody can hear me. I'll make it brief, but first I feel singularly honored to be, I guess, am I the only one here to do this? I think maybe I am. I don't know. I know some others that are still living, but apparently they're not present. But at any rate, first I'd like to point out I was very thankful to have the opportunity to live there. When I came to Ames in 1940, it was pretty much predetermined that I would stay on Lincoln Way with the Martin family. Yeah, that was known in Des Moines, where I'm from, and so there wasn't any second guessing about where I'd stay. And I got here. Fortunately, I moved in with a group of people. There are a couple of the Simmons that I've met since I was here. Archie Simmons, grandson, I guess. I think Archie is grandson of Mr. and Ms. Martin. But at any rate, we were fortunate to have the care and concern of the Martin family as we all moved in and were set on our course to try to get ourselves educated. It's interesting that young people today aren't aware of the fact that not only we couldn't stay in the dormitory here at Iowa State, but we couldn't not only here, but Iowa University or any other dormitory. They just assumed that you automatically stayed in those places. While there was a disadvantage of not being able to be directly on campus, there was an advantage because I was kind of a footloose kid that didn't know exactly what college was about. I was here to have fun. I thought it was going to be pretty much like high school and an extension. And I was fortunate enough to stay with graduate students, many of whom were from the South, where their tuition was being paid by their state so that they could come to Iowa State for the graduate degree. And that helped me because as I kind of fumbled around my first few weeks with the Martin family on me about not being a very good studious person from the standpoint of what their expectations were, along with these graduate students, it kind of got me on the ball. Iowa State had the reputation at that time of sending, we had a quarter system here, sending people home at Christmas time on a one-way trip. I mean, there was no return. And they told me, young man, if the Martins told me and these graduate students told me, young man, if you don't get your studies, you're not going to be here after Christmas. And that kind of saved me. But there was a home away from home atmosphere because of the dedication of these people. Interestingly enough, that picture on the invitation was just priceless. I just remembered them just like that. I thought they were that old when I was here. And I'm talking 1940. But they were a delightful couple. I think that they were strong disciplinarians. Mrs. Martin was on me more than one time about talking too loud. They didn't put up with a lot of foolishness. I think they'd had experience with college students, and they knew that if you were here, you ought to be here for business. And my tenure with them was not for the entire year. Toward the end of the year, we had an offer to move out on campus in another house, which we did. But I cherished the days and I stayed with them, and the path that they put me on, along with the other students, I can remember some names, maybe some of you remember. Herbert DeCosta was one. Archie Simmons, of course, I pointed out. Alphonse Douglas was one. Alonzo Meister. Sam Massey. A number of those people were all the people that helped put me on the right track. So I'm just thankful to be here, and I think I can speak for the ones who aren't, that they gave us a great start, and to a great extent, it counted for a great deal for us. And that's it.
Thank you. Appreciation from Iowa State University, and to make that lockstep between the initiatives of the Martin family and what's taking place at Iowa State University today, the Vice President of Student Affairs, Dr. Martin.
Thank you, Dr. Jackson, and I, on behalf of President Greg Joffre and the Iowa State University community, the family, I bring you greetings. First of all, I want to express appreciation to the Martin family. There's just two things basically I want to focus on, and that's appreciation for a couple things. Number one, well, several things. Being a part of this ceremony means a lot. Historically, from an African-American perspective, it means an awful lot. I want to thank them for making it possible for somebody like me to be here and to say that I'm Vice President for Student Affairs at Iowa State University. I'm standing on the shoulders of giants here, and the Martin family helped make that happen, and I want to express appreciation for that. The other thing I want to do, as Vice President for Student Affairs, I'm in charge of a few things, but there's some things that I'm in charge of that really relates to what they did. I'm responsible for housing all students. I'm also responsible for the Dean of Students Office, which is discipline. I'm responsible for the Counseling Center. Now think about what you've heard here. Think about what you've heard here. They were a member of this staff. They were housing. They were directors of housing. All right? I would say, you know, we owe them an awful lot. They were directors of housing. They were also directors, dean of students, if you would. Dean of men, dean of women, think about it. Dr. Bowman just told you that's what a dean of student does. I've also heard, talk to the gentleman here, about the African-Americans coming to aid when they got in trouble. You know who the police called? Archie Martin. They called him to check them out and get them straight. And they said that he did more than any police officer could do. He got them right. So these people, quite frankly, in my view, were very much a member of the Iowa State University family. They were like dean of students, director of housing, director of counseling. They did an outstanding job. And before I give this up, I want to express once again my appreciation, because no matter how good I think I might be, I wouldn't be here had it not been for people like Nancy and Archie Martin. Thanks a lot to the family.
Thanks, Tom. We're going to bring this to a close. Immediately after these ceremonies, there's a business meeting, which will start promptly at about 12:45 at 24th Street at the United Methodist Church there. In my final remarks, I'd like to say this. You know, a journey of 1,000 miles begins with one single step. When Nancy and Archie Martin took that step to allow black students who could not live on the campus of Iowa State University to live in their home, it created steps to progress. As Dr. Hill said before me, as we stand here today on this corner in this city, Iowa State University is indeed an open place. I can remember when I kept better numbers, the population of African American students living and studying at Iowa State University at one time approached the number of 961. I can't tell you exactly what the numbers are today, but had not the Martin family had the vision to provide a home away from home for students who aspired to get a college education, probably great things that's happening at Iowa State University would not be happening today. I learned from my sister, which was probably most appropriately expressed in something written by Shaw that best illustrates what a dream is. And it says, goes something like this. Some men see things as they are, and ask why. Evidently, the Martins dream things that never were, and ask why not. And because they did, we're all here today. Thank you for coming, and good morning.
Grandma Martin had a restaurant in Austell, and a doctor and Mrs. Grice, they were both doctors, from Ames, Iowa, would come down during the season, and they would eat at Grandma Martin's restaurant, and they told them that Ames was a place to come because there was a lot of money in Ames. It's a college town. And so Grandma and Grandpa, doing me good, Grandma and Grandpa Martin came to Ames. And then eventually there was an exodus. There was Mom and Papa, Uncle Paul, Uncle Bob, Uncle Archie, Aunt Julia and her husband. They all came to Ames, and we were just about with the first African Americans in Ames. There were two or three other families. But it was a lovely place to be. Back then there was 11,000 people, I remember. I was a smart little girl back then. I was nosy. And that was with the exception of Iowa State. Now you're a big town with 50-some thousand exception. Great. But it's still a lovely town, and we always came back when Mama was here to family reunions. Now, I'd like to give you a little history of watching the history of Grandma and Grandpa. There are other things I've been asked to say. The house. Uncle Paul, Uncle Bob, and Uncle Archie built the house for Grandma and Grandpa Martin back in the 20s, I guess. The house cost $12,000. Can you imagine that? And that is when they started keeping the African American students. And then we were the first grandchildren. There was Johnny, who was deceased, Lamar and me, we came along, we're here. And we loved Grandma and Grandpa Martin, but Grandpa was the sweetest little old man you ever wanted to see. He had a nickname. Grandma gave him a nickname of Sakaguchi. And Grandma Martin was stern, but she was a smart woman. She was the strength of the family, as most women are. Uncle Paul, Uncle Bob, especially Uncle Paul and Uncle Bob, Uncle Archie lived in Des Moines. But we would love to have Christmas time because we were the only children. And they all just gave us all of these presents, and we were so sorry when they got married. Children of their own. They married twins, the Jackman girls, Esther and Ethel, from Boone, and each had lovely children. Now, will the progeny, now all of us are progeny of Grandma and Grandpa, as you well know, would the progeny of Uncle Paul raise your hand or stand? Come on. Stand up, all of you, great grandchildren and all. Stand up.
Tell you too much about my grandmother Martin, but I could tell you quite a bit about my grandpa Martin. He was 102 years old when he passed away, and I was 12 years old when he passed away. And as I grew up as a young boy, my mother would cook dinner for him in the evenings, and I'd have to take it over to him on my bicycle. You know, at his age, by then he was in his late 90s, and at that time he was a little too old to be cooking for himself. So he was in a wheelchair, and I would go over every day after school and deliver the food to him. And he was an ex-slave. He was 12 years old when he got out of slavery, is what he told me. And he was a very noble type of a man. He used to be a plasterer, and he had a son that also lived with him that was a gentleman by the last name of Simmons. Now, when I say it was his son, it was actually his stepson. Was Grandma Martin's son by first marriage. His name was Ernest. And the two of them lived together. And when somebody mentioned earlier that some people look like they are from antiquity, these people were old when I was 12. I mean, very, very old. But yet they were young at heart. Beyond the kind you would never forget who they were once you had met them. So, but I remember they would get in spats with each other, and my grandmother, Grandma Ship, used to go over and spend time trying to straighten everything out. And my mother, Archie Lou Green, as I mentioned, would take and cook dinner for him every night, and I would get on the bike, big basket. Those bikes in the old days, you know, they had those big baskets on the front, so she'd put all the food in there and wrap it in foil, and I'd take it over there to him in the evening and spend some time with him while he ate. And watching him pass away was a very difficult thing for me, because there went a lot of history, and that's what I do remember about Archie Martin.
All right, Fred.
Not too long. They always say that to me. You know, this lady taught me some words like Grandpa Martin taught me some words. I used to have a word with Grandpa Martin that I would say, well, and he would say, boy, he said, you know what a well is. So it's a hole in the ground with water in it. So I learned about well, in other words, that's kind of an alliteration, you know, like, well. He said, no, he said, when you want to start to talk, have what you want to say in your mind and say it. So I learned about the word assignation. I didn't know what assignation was, but I was told about assignation. So for you who don't know what the word assignation is, look it up. So I got education from all kinds of people. Thelma, Julianelle, Leo, Edward, Chet. See, what I said before about the spirit of the old people not going away, it doesn't, because it just percolates. It just keeps coming down to each generation. So when Grant and I, because we were first cousins growing up together, we were sort of nurtured and sort of moved by some of these older brothers and sisters and cousins. And so the one thing I forgot to mention earlier, because I couldn't relate all my personal stuff, but the thing that really kept me on the right track was Grandpa Martin's close, what's the word, mentoring, tutoring, I guess, more than mentoring, tutoring. Because he taught me how to garden. There was a plot of land next to the house that used to be tilled every spring. And it became my garden because he showed me how to grow things out there. How to tie up beans and tomatoes and corn. There was a cherry tree out there. I took care of the cherry tree. He had a couple of apple trees behind the house directly. I used to try to lie out there and try to watch to see when an apple would fall off the tree. I never get to see that. I mean, it never happened. I keep watching the apple, but it would always fall off sometime later. But anyway, Granddad taught me a lot of things that I sort of used later on in life, and it was very nice. But the one thing that both of them taught me, and you're right, Grandma was kind of a stern person, but I didn't have that much connection with her, even though I ate her food. I would come to the house, and there'd be these moon pies sitting on the stove, and I would ask her for a moon pie, and she would certainly have a moon pie. But then later on, I'd have another one, but I didn't ask her about that one. So, anyway, Grandma, it was mainly just being nice and learning how to say yes, ma'am, and no, ma'am, and being respectful to people.
But the one thing I want to leave you with is the reason that I perhaps have stayed in school. When I was a young boy, the grandparents always told me, because they could neither read or write, you must go to school. 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 Okay, you hear that from the time you're like this till you're quite about like this. You must go to school. You must go to school. Why must you go to school? Well, their admonition was that being children of grandchildren and children of slave people, the education is the way in which we can make our way. Okay? And when you're small, you don't understand that, but as you get older, you understand that. So every year, the time I was in nursery school, from the time I was in seventh grade, I would come to my grandparents on graduation day with my report card. I would run there because they would give me a silver dollar each. And my birthday and graduation happened within 2 days of each other. One day my birthday, next day graduation. And then also get my silver dollars. So silver dollars plus they're telling me all my life, you must go to school, plus being around all the college students was my final tribute or sense to them, because I remember them being these people who never had opportunities. Well, I had them. So their thing was, you're going to make use of them. Otherwise, they may kick you out and not come back after Christmas.
I don't know how many of you remember our beloved baby sister, Archie Lou. She has her son here, and he would like to say something. Bruce Green.
A phenomenal, wonderful time. Grandma, she has a daughter, Grandpa Mark. Grandpa Mark was a tremendous person of legacy, and Grandpa Chip, tremendous man. I remember when we used to live in Omaha, they would come to visit us at Christmas time. And I remember one time I was fiddling around with an electrical light and sticking it in the socket, and I got shocked and kind of knocked me on my can. Grandma sat in her lap, and Grandpa came over and comforted me, you know, there, now, you know. And I'll never forget that. And just one of the things as I grew up, because they died, my grandpa died young, and I really wanted to know him more than I did. So what I ended up doing is I ran around asking my brothers and sisters and my aunts and uncles about my grandparents. And something that I would like to leave you young people with, I want you to really hear me carefully, is it's very, very important what Freddie said about basically about legacy. And that is the passing on of the information, the love, and the character qualities of your ancestors onto you. And one of the wonderful things about that, it's not only pictured in this gathering here that Grandma Ship was big on, and certainly Grandpa Ship was big on, if you've been alive too as well, and all of our ancestors, is just the importance of family gatherings, remembering one another, and remember where we came from. And as Freddie was talking about education, that is very, very important for us not to just drop off, just kind of fade off, thinking that there's no hope at all. But to know that it's important to get a good education. Another thing that's very important for us to do as a people, and that is not to deny our spiritual heritage. Freddie talked about that in our spiritual, in the prayer. And certainly Grandma Martin and Grandpa Martin knew the Lord Jesus. Grandma Ship knew him very well, very well. And I remember when we were out to visit Grandma Ship in Washington, D.C. For the last time, I built a church for church pulpit for a church in New Jersey, so we dropped down to see Grandma Lynn and Ann and Grandma Ship. It was a really, really wonderful time. And a lot of that spiritual legacy that she left us, she really loved Jesus, and she talked really admirably and highly about all the wonderful blessings that he had done for her. One of those great things that was manifest in her and was always on her lips was her children remembering her, Franklin remembering her, you know, and Mildred remembering her, and Lamar and Johnny. I remember Uncle Johnny used to go come over and skin those catfish and those carp, and old your brother Bob, old Paul, come over to catfish, yeah, and see those ugly fish in the sink and said, who's going to skin those stinking things out? And her brother said, it was always that family. It was always reunited. So here we are as family together, remembering them. And so legacy. So when you young kids, as you remember your mom and your dad, remember your grandparents and where they came from, the little old city here in Iowa, Timbuktu compared to maybe New York or Los Angeles or Chicago or Oregon or wherever you may be, this is kind of where it started in a sense. And we're ever so grateful to our ancestors here. We're really also grateful to the people who loved us special here, Calvary Methodist and the community names who are here. You're very, very dear to us, and we just thank you for being a part of this. Thank you very much.
You know, as I look around, I see some people, you know, the young people are really doing great. I met a young lady yesterday. She's a cousin, second or third, I don't know. But she looked like she was about 12 years old, and this fall, she's going to Johns Hopkins University. She's going to train to be a brain surgeon. Will you please stand? Yeah. Where is she? Oh, isn't that wonderful? And you know we have people in this family, progeny of grandma and grandpa, that anything you need, we've got it. With those who are nurses, please raise your hand. We have a dentist. You don't have to say anything, Freddie. Robert, please stand. Robert Bickerstaff, please stand. The dentist, you and Freddie. You can get up. Attorneys in our family. Will the attorneys please stand? Okay. Now we have a lot of people in our family who are teachers, and they tell me they have military careers. That guy is over doing something. That's Grantman. Accounting, finance, and law, graphic design. Why don't you just raise your hand when I call these things? Engineering. That's my heart right there. Say that again. That is. I just love this place. For NASA, you know what that is. And you see that one back there? Stand up again. Stand up. I happened to be looking in an engineering magazine one day, and I looked and I said, hey, this guy looks familiar. It was a conference in Paris, France, and it was Butch. Butch, you stand up again. From a very proud family, a very talented family. I can't name all of Ruth listed all these things. Construction, David. What? David, you're a boss of something. Stand up. David Martin. How about the law enforcement? Where is the law enforcement? Where is it? And you see this little lady over here? She's trained in, she's specially trained in food services and how to do everything. And she didn't have to learn how to be a boss because she's like me, she just like any boss. All right, now, social services and tourism, entertainment. Where is my other sweetheart? Jeremiah. Jeremiah,
Uncle
know, and all of our friends who are here, you know that the Martin progeny has it all. Thank you. Okay, but I've got the microphone now. I just want to challenge you, as the grandchildren grow older, I'm going to challenge the next generations to keep in touch and keep doing this so you don't lose track of your heritage. Okay, and we're trying to put a book together about the Martin, Archie and Nancy. No disrespect intended. So that we have information and things to share. You're going to have to pay for your own. So as we send you information or ask for pictures or stuff, please respond. We will give your pictures back. We don't keep other people's pictures. But we really want to go forward on this. So please be thinking about what you want in there. Include your spouses and what you've done educationally and your work history and whatever, and we'll try to do a good job. We'd like to get it done soon so we can do one for Paul and Esther's kids. Okay? And, you know, I just, as far as our grandparents, we had the privilege of living in their home while our folks built their house. And we peeked through the curtain a lot at the students. And we remember Grandma rushing around the kitchen and making ice cream and ice cube trays and sitting on the porch, counting the license plates from various states, because there was one road across the country, Lincoln Highway, watching the circus when it came through town and they unloaded and they were going from one point to another, and just many things. And I think some of it was at the end of World War I. So there are lots of memories that we haven't talked about, and I hope that before the weekend's over we can share more of them. But it's wonderful that you all came, and I also want to give Mildred credit for helping to get so many of you out. She was a great cheerleader, and give her a big hand. There is an advantage to being the oldest. You know, the younger ones that kind of look up to you, little lady. And I have called Val. You're going to say something. I wanted to say, when I called them, I say, you better come.
Okay, I'm Val Ship. And Val Ship Jr. First, I want to give the ladies a hand in the kitchen. Now, they asked me to come up here, and I also say that it's a beautiful thing to be around family. I don't get a chance to see many of you because we're on the East Coast, and I've never been to Ames. Which is a joke between Fred and I. At any rate, don't have a chance to see very many of the family that is here today because we live on the East Coast, so it's really good to see everyone. Now, they have asked me to come forward because my experience with my aunt has been a long one. We've always had a lot of fun together through the years, and we have put together a plaque for her to recognize her contribution over the years. I'll just read it for you. A Family Appreciation Award presented to Mildred Ship Crouch, or we call her Mrs. Hubert B. Crouch, for years of dedicated, caring support. Thank you from your family on August 10th, 2002. And so, in appreciation to Mrs. Hubert B. Crouch, we want to say thank you, Aunt Millie. the bottom of our hearts.
You know, pretty soon I'm going to be as long-winded as Freddie. But I keep thinking, thank you so much for that. And I'll bet you that was Ames started that. But anyway, there was a young man came up to you today. He is from Los Angeles, California, and he said, I'm Darwin. Now, Uncle Al had a son named Darwin. He was a jockey. Famous jockey, Darwin Jr., would you please stand? He has never seen any of it. I'll give you something now. This one, this is Uncle Al's son. He was the worst little boy you ever wanted to see. He was second to none. I think Lamar was the worst of all. But anyway, see how they turned out? They were so successful. Now he wants to say something.
I'm really not the rebel without a cause because I do have a cause. But in my early years, I was born in Ames, Iowa, in a house right next to 218 Lincoln Way. And I remember it distinctly because we had dirt floors in that house. And when Freddie said something about the garden, it was in the back of it. I remember that because it was right in front of the little church in the Vale, where we used to sing every Sunday, red and yellow, black and white, Jesus loves the children in his sight. And I can remember the house that they're trying to memorialize here on Lincoln Way, because you walk in the front door, the dining room was on the right, the living room was on the left. There was a bathroom on the corner, another room in the back, and Grandma Martin's, and Grandpa's room was there. And you went up the stairs, and there was maybe seven rooms upstairs where the students were staying. And when I was there, going down to the basement, they had the stairs went right straight down. In front of it was what we called the bathroom. Then there was a bed over in the corner. You went around in the other room where the furnace was, and way in the back was the coal room. And the coal room was where my grandfather introduced me to a possum. They had caught a possum and they put it underneath a basket in that coal room. You weren't supposed to touch it. Well, unbeknownst to me, I went over and I kicked it. And that possum got out and the door was closed. So I can remember Grandpa saying, how you doing in there, son? And I said, that's all right, I'm going to catch him. And that possum and I ran around that room for about a half an hour to 45 minutes. When it was all over, I had that possum. And we also had a chopping block there in that basement where we used to cut off the chickens' heads and stuff like that. And then you went out into the back in the barn. There was a great big log out there where we used to wring the chickens' necks like you crank a Model T forward and let them go. And then let me go down the alley here to Sherman. To Aunt Nell's house. You walk into Aunt Nell's house, living room on the right, and then there was a set of stairs, went upstairs to the bathroom was on the left, and there was a sewing room there on the right. And I remember that the girls all used to be upstairs, you know, so when the boys had all come, you know, Aunt Nell would be running, what's going on up there? You know, and then you went downstairs, and you went around the corner there, and we had a basement there. No wooden basement, ground floor, weren't unfinished, but had fruits and vegetables lined around the wall. And all the boys from the college would come out to visit all the girls in the Martin clan. Ship clan and Martin clan, it was a job to keep them in line. But in any event, I eventually left there when I was a little teeny tyke, and I went to Belle Plaine, Iowa, which is 80 miles east of here. And I graduated from high school there and went into services, what have you. But I traveled back and forth to Ames, Iowa to visit my grandmother and grandpa. And they could never find me when I went to Ames because I was always one fair place where grandma did the very best work, and that was in the kitchen. And if they were looking for Robert, Robert was in the pantry. And grandma made the best chicken pot pies you ever tasted in your life. Apple pies, peach pies.
And in Kenton, we had a big pot that had a big coal stove sitting over there on one side. On the other side was the counter for ground beater bread and stuff like that. I know the house now. I know all the houses. And I can remember the time as a little kid going to Lincoln School. Mrs. Mitchell was the principal. And when I was in kindergarten, no, nursery school, they made it, there was a school law that Robert E. Martin didn't go out for recess. They kept me in school because I was incorrigible. But I was a star.
Go ahead.
But the Martin family has a long heritage. My daughter here, and my grandson, and my daughter's husband, and I have another daughter, Cindy. She's a professional scholar. She continues to go to school, seeking something that I never found, I guess. But whatever it was, when I look around over this sea of humanity here, and look over there and see a lot of the people that I used to be associated with, you know, and I watch them as they grow up, you know, and what have you. It's been an indulgence that I really anticipated and I really enjoyed. And I tell my grandson quite a bit about our heritage and things of this nature. But to be thankful cannot be expressed in words. So I'm going to leave with you this thought that I love you, and if I love you, God loves you.
Anybody else? Well, again, I want, yes, and someone else wants to say something. Lamar, he said no. Lamar said no. Lamar said he's gotten to the age when he opened